Hello class 12 students, here I am going to discuss about 6th part of the video, and in this part we will discuss vapor pressure of liquid solution. And in this we will discuss two main topics, and these topics are vapor pressure of liquid in liquid and vapor pressure of solid in liquid type solution. Now let's start. Here first is vapor pressure of solutions of liquids in liquids. As in our previous videos, I have already discussed that in this chapter solution, we will only discuss about binary solution. So here also, we are discussing about a binary solution of liquid in liquid type. It means we have two liquids which are mixed and they form a solution of liquid solution. Now let us consider a binary solution of two volatile liquid. For vapor pressure condition, we have suppose a condition that we have a binary solution, and in this solution we have two volatile liquids, and these liquids in a solution can be denoted by two components because it is a binary solution. So it has two components, and these two components can be denoted by component 1 and component 2. Now when this volatile liquid is taken in a closed vessel, then let us suppose we have a closed vessel. This is a closed vessel, and in this closed vessel we have a liquid solution in which two volatile liquids are present, because we are talking about our binary solution. Here two liquids are present in the solution. Now the component of liquid have two component, and this liquid, one component of this liquid can be denoted by 1, and other component of this liquid can be denoted by 2. And since we have already discussed that the liquid which is making a solution, liquid solution, these are volatile in nature. So as it is volatile in nature, so it has a tendency to get evaporate. The liquid which is volatile in nature has a tendency to get evaporate. Means agar wo liquid volatile hai nature mein, to uske jo molecules hai wo evaporation show karenge. तो वही सिमिलर केस जो ये दो लिक्विड्स प्रेजेंट है सॉल्यूशन में, इनके साथ भी अप्लाई होगा. होगा क्या, इस ये जो लिक्विड मॉलिक्यूल्स हैं, ये आके क्या करने लगेंगे, एवोपरेशन स्टार्ट होगा. तो इसके जो पार्टिकल्स हैं इनके, वो आके कहां जाएंगे, सरफेस, लिक्विड सरफेस के ऊपर आके एक्युमुलेट हो जाएंगे. द वेपर पार्टिकल्स ऑफ दीज लिक्विड कैन गेट एक्युमुलेट ऑन द सरफेस, ओवर द सरफेस ऑफ द लिक्विड इन द फॉर्म ऑफ वेपर. They will get accumulate. Now what will happen, as they get accumulate over the surface of the liquid, then what will happen, the equilibrium will develop between two phases. An equilibrium can develop between two phases, between a vapor phase, this is vapor phase, and this is our liquid phase. An equilibrium established between these two phases. As the vapor starts moving over the solution of liquid, and after moving upward they have a tendency to move down also. So at a certain time they generate a situation, and that situation is known as an equilibrium situation. It means jitne vapors water liquid solution se form ho rahe the aur wo upar jaake is vapor phase mein aake accumulate ho rahe the, utne hi vapor kya honge yahan se wapas bhi ja rahe honge liquid phase mein. So ye jo ek situation generate current, that situation is known as equilibrium. Aur is equilibrium situation pe dono ke dono condition, vapor bhi, vapor phase aur liquid phase, dono ke vapors upar niche aake move kar rahe, to ye jo situation aage, that situation is known as equilibrium state. Aur at equilibrium state, the pressure which is exerted by the vapor to the liquid surface, that pressure is known as vapor pressure. So we have to discuss and we have to learn about this vapor pressure of solution of liquid and liquid type. जो वेपर प्रेशर उस इक्विलिब्रियम कंडीशन से जनरेट हुआ है, वो जो वेपर्स ऊपर गई और वही वेपर्स फिर से नीचे जा रही है, तो एक प्रेशर अप्लाई कर रही है उस सॉल्यूशन में। ये वेपर्स ऊपर गई और यही वेपर्स फिर नीचे सॉल्यूशन में जा रही है, तो एक प्रेशर एग्जर्ट कर रही है, और ये जो प्रेशर डेवलप हो रहा है इक्विलिब्रियम कंडीशन में, दैट प्रेशर इज नोन एज वेपर प्रेशर। और इसी प्रेशर को हमने इस लिक्विड और लिक्विड टाइप सॉल्यूशन के लिए डिस्कस करना है। नाउ For component 1, when component 1 is present in the solution, it is denoted by 1. For component 1, the vapors of component 1 can get to the vapor phase and they have some pressure. That pressure can be denoted by P1. Partial pressure of component 1. Similarly, vapors of component 2 can, when they get to the vapor phase, they have some pressure, and that pressure can be denoted by P2, because we are talking about component 2. Then the pressure of component 2 can be denoted as P2. So we have P1 and P2 are the partial vapor pressures of two components, component 1 and component 2 respectively. Now, as component 1 and component 2 have the partial vapor pressure, so on combining these two components, the total pressure of the solution, total vapor pressure of the solution can be denoted as P total. Now from here, as the component 1 is present in the liquid, so it has some amount. As it is present in the liquid, so it has some amount. That amount can be denoted as its mole fraction. So for component 1, the mole fraction of component 1 is x1. And similarly for component 2, when component 2 is present in the solution, it also has some amount. And for the amount, the mole fraction of component 2 can be denoted as x2. When both the components are present in the solution, then mole fraction of component 1 can be denoted as x1, and mole fraction of component 2 can be denoted as x2. Now, when the component 1 and 2 gets volatile to the vapor phase, then what will happen? At that time, the component 1 has a mole fraction, has an amount. At that time, the component 1 has an amount, and the mole fraction of component 1 in vapor phase can be denoted as y1. And similarly for component 2, mole fraction of component 2 in vapor phase can be denoted as y2. So here are some notation. The mole fraction of component 1 and 2 when they are in liquid phase, that can be denoted as x1 and x2. When the liquid gets evaporated to the vapor phase, then their mole fraction in vapor phase can be denoted as y1 and y2. Now let's see. After this, all the notation, a law has generated. This can further be explained by a law, and that law is known as Raoult's law. Let's see. Raoult's law states that for a solution of volatile liquids, the partial pressure of each component of the solution is directly proportional to its mole fraction. It means, for a volatile liquid, the partial vapor pressure of one component of the solution will be directly proportional to the mole fraction of the component present in the solution. But the condition is there that the temperature should be same. Now, according to the definition of Raoult's law, according to the statement of Raoult's law, suppose we are discussing about component 1, so the partial vapor pressure of component 1, P1, will be directly proportional to mole fraction of that component in the solution, that is x1. It means P1 is directly proportional to x1. And now, on removing this proportionality sign, a constant will be there. And this constant, now on removing the proportionality sign, the equation becomes that P1, the partial vapor pressure of component 1 will be equal to P1 naught into x1, where p1 naught is the vapor pressure of pure component 1. It means when component present in its pure form, then the vapor pressure of that component 1 is p1 naught. And according to Raoult's law, when we remove the proportionality sign, then the equation becomes that p1 equal to p1 naught, vapor pressure of pure component 1, into mole fraction of that component in the solution, that is x1. But the condition is at same temperature. Now coming to the component 2, as we come to component 2, the same equation will be, we can write the same equation for component 2. So partial pressure of component 2, that is p2, will be equal to partial pressure of component of pure component 2 into its mole fraction in solution. Here p2 naught represents the vapor pressure of the pure component 2. So from the equation, from the statement of Raoult's law, we can write an equation for both the components, for component 1 as well as for component 2. Now if we have to find out the total pressure, total vapor pressure of the solution, for total vapor pressure of the solution, here is a law, and that law is known as Dalton's law of partial pressure. As we have studied earlier, that Dalton's law of partial pressure states that the total pressure over the solution in the container will be the sum of the partial pressures of the component of the solution. Dalton's law states that the total vapor pressure, or the total pressure of the solution in the container, will be equal to the sum of the partial pressures of each component which is present in the solution. Now according to the statement of Dalton, now the equation will become as total pressure will be equal to partial pressures of component 1 and partial pressure of component 2. So here it is the Dalton's law of partial pressure which is used for finding out the total pressure which is present over the solution, and hence the total pressure becomes equal the partial pressure of component 1 and plus the partial pressure of component 2. Now here, on substituting the values of p1 and p2, we will get total pressure will be equal to p1 naught, partial vapor pressure of pure component into its mole fraction, plus partial vapor pressure of component 2, pure component 2, and its mole fraction p2 naught into x2. Now in this equation, if we replace mole fraction of component 1, that is x1, as we all know that mole fraction of component 1 plus mole fraction of component 2, that is summation of two mole fraction of two component, that is always equal to 1. If we replace mole fraction of component 1 in this equation, if we replace mole fraction of component 1, then what will we get? We will get mole fraction of component 1 will be x1 will be equal to 1 minus x2. So from this, on putting the value of x1 in the equation of total pressure, we will get 1 minus x2 into p1 naught plus p2 naught into x2. On rearranging the equation, after rearranging the equation and taking x2 as common from p2 naught and p1 naught, we will get a final equation, and in this equation what we will get, we get total pressure will be equal to partial pressure of pure component 1 plus mole fraction of component 2 multiplied by partial vapor pressure of pure component 2 minus partial vapor pressure of pure component 1. From this equation, we get the total pressure. And total pressure in terms of mole fraction of component 2. Why in terms of mole fraction of component 2? Because initially we replaced mole fraction of component 1, that is x1, with mole fraction of component 2 here. So the similar equation can be from when we replace mole fraction of component 2, as we replace mole fraction of component 2 by mole fraction of component 1, we will get the same equation if we replace x2. x2 will be equal to 1 minus of x1. So we will get the same equation as we replace x2 from in the initial equation from in this equation. If we replace x2, we will get same equation, but the terms are changed in this condition. Now, as we replace x2 by x1, what will we get? We will get the total pressure will be equal to the partial vapor pressure of pure component 2. Here it will be 2 now. Partial vapor pressure of pure component 2 plus mole fraction of component 1 multiplied by partial vapor pressure of component 1 minus partial vapor pressure of component 2. So this, by this way, we can express the total pressure in terms of the mole fraction of any one of the component in the solution. Since as हमने क्या करा, हमने इनिशियली क्या करा, यहाँ पे जो इक्वेशन हमें स्क्रीन पे शो हो रहा है, इस इक्वेशन में हमने क्या करा हुआ है, हमने एक का मोल फ्रैक्शन, उस इक्वेशन से हमने एक कंपाउंड के मोल फ्रैक्शन को हमने रिप्लेस कर दिया, मतलब हमने उस कंपाउंड का जो अमाउंट था उसको हमने कम करा और उसको हमने रिप्लेस करके उसमें कंपाउंड दो, कंपाउंड जो सेकेंड कंपाउंड है मोल फ्रैक्शन ऑफ कंपाउंड टू, उसको हम उसमें ऐड कर रहे हैं. मींस हमने कंपाउंड वन को रिप्लेस कर दिया, हम उसमें क्या ऐड कर रहे हैं, हम कंपाउंड टू को ऐड कर रहे हैं. तो इट मींस जो हमें टोटल प्रेशर, हमें लास्ट में जो इक्वेशन मिलेगी टोटल प्रेशर की, वो केवल डिपेंड करेगी उस कंपाउंड पे जो अब सॉल्यूशन में प्रेजेंट है, क्योंकि हमने एक जो कंपाउंड था, कंपाउंड वन जो था, हमने तो उसको रिप्लेस कर दिया. अब जो प्रेशर डिपेंड करेगा वो किस पे करेगा, प्रेशर हमेशा उसी पे डिपेंड करेगा जो सॉल्यूशन में कंपाउंड प्रेजेंट है, उसी के वेपर ऊपर जा पाएंगे. तो अब वेपर किसके ऊपर जा रहे हैं, कंपाउंड टू के, क्योंकि हमने उसको रिप्लेस करा हुआ है कंपाउंड वन को कंपाउंड टू से. तो अब जो प्रेशर होगा, टोटल प्रेशर, इट विल डिपेंड ओनली ऑन एनी ऑफ द कंपाउंड, आइदर कंपाउंड वन और कंपाउंड टू. नाउ फ्रॉम दिस इक्वेशन we can conclude some points from this equation. Now first point is the total vapor pressure over the solution can be related to the mole fraction of any component. It means the pressure which is present over the solution of the liquid can be related to its mole fraction of any of the component, which we have discussed here, that the total pressure after finalizing the equation, the total vapor pressure over the solution, means above the liquid surface, over the solution, can be related to the mole fraction of any component. Now, here, the total vapor pressure over the solution, one more point, we can conclude that total vapor pressure over the solution varies linearly with mole fraction of component 2 or 1. Here in this equation, the total vapor pressure, this is total vapor pressure, this will varies linearly with mole fraction of component 2. This is component 2. It will vary linearly with component 2. And if we replace component 2 initially in the solution, then the total vapor pressure will depend on linearly varies with the mole fraction of component 1. Now, from this point, we can conclude that if we draw a line between vapor pressure and mole fraction, what we will get, since vapor pressure and mole fraction both lies linearly, as they lies linearly with each other, so we can get a linear line here, straight line between vapor pressure of one component and mole fraction of that component, which lie linearly with each other. So this is the conclusion which we can conclude by Raoult's law or by this equation. Now the third conclusion is, depending on the vapor pressure of pure component 1 and 2, the total vapor pressure over the solution decreases or increases with increase in mole fraction of the component. Now, let's see. This is the graph of vapor pressure versus mole fraction. Now, what will happen? We can see in this, what will happen, since at this point, This is the point where only the amount of component 1 is there. When there is only compound 1 is present, then the mole fraction of compound 1 will be equal to 1. And at this time here, the compound 2 is 0. It means the mole fraction of compound 2 will also be 0. And here is the point. In this graph, we are talking about two components. In the same graph, we are talking about component 1. This is the line for component 1. This is the line for component 1. And this line is for component 2. Here, this is the point where only component 2 is present in the solution. Only component 2 present in the solution means the mole fraction of component 2 will be 1. But the mole fraction of component 1 will be 0. This is the point. Now, the line which is representing the vapor pressure of component 1. This is the line which is representing the vapor pressure of component 1. And this is the line which is representing the vapor pressure of component 2. Here, in this line, the point is there where the component 1 has some vapor pressure. It means at this point only the component 1 is present. So in this line, the vapor pressure of pure component 1 will be there. Same for component 2, since in this side we are talking about component 2, and in component 2, in this line, the point will be there where the partial pressure of pure component 2 will lie. And this is the point where the partial pressure of pure component 2 lies. Now from the point, we can say that सॉल्यूशन है हमारे पास. उस सॉल्यूशन में हम धीरे धीरे क्या कर रहे हैं, हमारे पास उस सॉल्यूशन में एक पॉइंट था, हमने यहां से स्टार्ट करा और इस पॉइंट पे हमारे पास केवल कंपोनेंट ए प्रेजेंट था. अब इस पॉइंट में जब केवल कंपोनेंट 1 प्रेजेंट है, तो अब धीरे धीरे क्या हुआ, हमने कंपोनेंट उसको हमने सॉल्यूशन बनाना तैयार करा, तो हम उसमें कंपोनेंट 2 भी ऐड करते जा रहे हैं. एंड एज वी आर एडिंग कंपोनेंट 2 इन कंपोनेंट 1, तो जो अमाउंट है कंपोनेंट 1 का वो क्या होता रहेगा, धीरे धीरे डिक्रीज करता रहेगा. कंपोनेंट 1 अभी 1 था, उसका अमाउंट, उसका मोल फ्रैक्शन 1 था. धीरे धीरे हम उसमें 2 भी ऐड कर रहे हैं, तो कंपाउंड उसका जो मोल फ्रैक्शन है वो क्या होगा, धीरे धीरे डिक्रीज करेगा. एज वी आर मूविंग फ्रॉम लेफ्ट टू राइट टूवर्ड्स हम x2 की साइड को जाएंगे, तो वो डिक्रीज करेगा. नाउ अब यहां से हमें फर्दर क्या कंक्लूजन, अगर x1 डिक्रीज कर रहा है, तो जो अमाउंट है x2 का वो हम ऐड कर रहे हैं, तो अमाउंट जो है x2 का सॉल्यूशन में क्या होने लगेगा, इंक्रीज करने लगेगा. और हम उस पॉइंट तक जाएंगे जहां पे x1 पूरा का पूरा खत्म हो जाए, x1 का अमाउंट खत्म हो जाए, लेकिन अब किसका अमाउंट रह जाए सॉल्यूशन में, केवल x2 का अमाउंट रह जाए. तो ये ग्राफ हमें ये इंडिकेट कर रहा है. उस सेम टाइम पे जब हमारे पास में हम लाउड्स लॉ के बेसिस पे हम आगे डिस्कस कर चुके हैं कि जो प्रेशर है वो लीनियरली वेरी कर रहा है किसके साथ, मोल फ्रैक्शन के साथ. अगर हमने प्रेशर लिया, अगर हम बात करें प्रेशर की, प्रेशर अगर हम कंपोनेंट 2 का ले रहे हैं, तो वो किसके साथ वेरी कर रहा है, कंपोनेंट 1 के साथ, क्योंकि हमने रिप्लेस किसको कर दिया था वहां पे, कंपोनेंट 2 को रिप्लेस कर दिया था 1 से, ये हमने डिस्कस कर लिया. और उस टाइम पे हम प्रेशर किसकी बात कर रहे होते हैं, कंपोनेंट 2 की, वो उसके साथ वेरी करने लग जाते हैं. अगर हम रिप्लेस 1 को कर रहे हैं, तो 1 को करेंगे तो सॉल्यूशन में केवल कंपोनेंट 2 रहा, तो अब जो प्रेशर वेरी करेगा वो किसके साथ वेरी करेगा, कंपोनेंट 1 के साथ वेरी करने लग जाएगा. सो फ्रॉम द ग्राफ वी कैन से दैट एज वी ड्रॉ अ लाइन इन बिटवीन वेपर प्रेशर एंड मोल फ्रैक्शन ऑफ द कंपोनेंट, देन वी विल गेट अ स्ट्रेट लाइन फ्रॉम फॉर x1, जहां पे x1 की कुछ वैल्यू है, उसके लिए जो ग्राफ होगा उसकी क्या आएगी, स्ट्रेट लाइन आएगी, जो कहां जाके लाइन अप होगी, p2 के प्रेशर के यहाँ पे जाके, क्योंकि वो उसी के साथ वेरी कर रहा था. फॉर द सेम वे डेट लाइन इज विल बी वेपर प्रेशर ऑफ कंपोनेंट p. डेट लाइन डिनोट वेपर प्रेशर ऑफ कंपोनेंट p2. This is for second component. And if we are talking about component 1, vapor pressure of component 1, then this is the line of solution. When they get mixed, वेपर प्रेशर ऑफ द सॉल्यूशन, जब सॉल्यूशन की बात हो रही, प्योर की बात नहीं, जब सॉल्यूशन की बात हो रही तब ये ग्राफ तब डिस्कस हो रहा है। तो जब वेपर प्रेशर, हम कंपोनेंट वन का हमें वेपर प्रेशर चाहिए, जब सॉल्यूशन में कंपोनेंट वन था, वन वन आके खत्म हुआ, टू उसमें ऐड कर दिया, उस वाले का जब हम वेपर प्रेशर की बात करें तो वो लाइन कहाँ आ जाएगी, ये प्योर कंपोनेंट को ज्वाइन कर रही है, पी वन विल बी इक्वल टू पी नॉट वन इंटू एक्स वन, इसको जो ज्वाइन करने वाली लाइन होगी वो होगी हमारे पास में प्योर वेपर प्रेशर ऑफ कंपोनेंट वन। एंड द लाइन विच इज डिनोटेड विथ दिस सॉलिड लाइन, दिस इज नोन एज टोटल वेपर प्रेशर ऑफ कंपोनेंट वन एंड कंपोनेंट टू विच आर प्रेजेंट इन द सॉल्यूशन, दिस इज द टोटल वेपर प्रेशर ऑफ द सॉल्यूशन, दिस लाइन डिनोट्स टोटल वेपर प्रेशर समेशन ऑफ पी वन प्लस पी टू। नाउ here we are discussing about the vapor pressure of two pure components and these both are volatile in nature and here the p1 is below as compared to p2 naught, p1 naught is below as compared to p2 naught, what is denotes, it denotes that partial vapor pressure of component 1, pure component 1 is less than the partial vapor pressure of pure component 2. It means in a solution when two components are there, the amount of component 1 will be less as compared to the amount of component 2. More the amount of the component, more will be its vapor pressure. More the amount of the liquid, more it will can vaporize. So as the amount of component 1 is less in the solution, that's why the partial vapor pressure of pure component will be less as compared to partial vapor pressure of pure component 2. Now, if we have to find out the partial vapor pressure in vapor phase, now for this the formula, we have a formula, if y1 and y2 are mole fraction of components 1 and 2 respectively in vapor phase, as we have discussed earlier in the starting of the video, that if we are talking in vapor phase, and in vapor phase the component 1 and component 2 has the mole fraction and that can be denoted by y1 and y2. Now on using Dalton's law, the partial vapor pressure of component 1 in vapor phase will be equal to mole fraction in vapor phase y1 into total pressure. Similarly, partial vapor pressure of component 2 will be equal to mole fraction of component 2 into total pressure. In general, if we are talking about IF component, then partial vapor pressure of IF component will be equal to mole fraction of IF component in vapor phase multiplied by its total pressure. Now let's come to the next point. Here in this point we will discuss about vapor pressure of solutions of solids and liquids. As we have already discussed about vapor pressure of liquids and liquids which make a liquid solution, now in this case we are talking about vapor pressure of solids and liquids. When we mix a solid to a liquid, then what will happen? For such type of example and for such type to study such type of topic, we need for this the solute added to the solvent should be non-volatile. The solute which we are adding to the liquid, it should be non-volatile in nature. Now let's start. Suppose in a container a pure liquid is taken. In a container, here it is in container one, here it is pure solvent is present. Now in pure liquid, the entire surface is occupied by the molecules of the liquid. As we all know that if we have a container and in that container we have pure liquid in it, so what does it mean? It means the pure in the pure liquid, the entire surface will be occupied by the molecules of the liquid because there is only a pure liquid in the container. Now if a non-volatile solute is added to the solvent and which are making a solution, if a non-volatile solute is added to that solvent which we have taken in a beaker, and And after adding a non-volatile solute, the solute and solvent both will make a solution. Now what will happen? The vapor pressure of solution is solely from the solvent alone. Now as we add the non-volatile solute to the solvent, now the vapors which are above the surface of the solution are only from solvent, not from solute. Why it is not from solute? Why? Because we added a non-volatile solute. And as we added a non-volatile solute, then the how can it form a vapors? As it already a non-volatile compound, it can't get vaporized. It can't get evaporate. So only a solvent can get evaporate, and only the vapors come from a solvent part. Now, what happens after this? This vapor pressure of the solution at the given temperature is found to be lower than the vapor pressure of pure solvent at the same temperature. On adding a non-volatile solute, a condition occurs. And that condition is this vapor pressure which is due to the vapors of only the solvent molecules, this vapor pressure of the solution at the given temperature is found to be lower than the vapor pressure of the pure solvent at the same temperature. It means agar hamare paas mein ek container mein humne pure solvent liya tha, suppose humne water liya hua tha और क्लोज कंटेनर था, हमने उसमें वाटर लिया, प्योर सॉल्वेंट, तो एवोपरेशन होगा वाटर का, थोड़ी देर के बाद वाटर के मॉलिक्यूल्स वेपर फेज में आ जाएंगे और वो वेपर फेज में आने के बाद एक प्रेशर डेवलप करेंगे, क्योंकि इक्विलिब्रियम कंडीशन हो जाएगी, तो एक प्रेशर डेवलप करेंगे और वो जो प्रेशर डेवलप होगा, यहां से जो प्रेशर डेवलप होगा उस प्रेशर को हम बोलेंगे वेपर प्रेशर. जो यहाँ प्रेशर डेवलप हो रहा है वाटर के सरफेस में, उसको हम बोलेंगे वेपर प्रेशर. नाउ अगर हम सॉलिड वेपर प्रेशर हमने चेक करना है सॉलिड्स एंड लिक्विड्स, तो होगा क्या, जैसे ही हमने कोई नॉन वॉलेटाइल सॉलिड ऐड कर दिया, इस सॉल्यूशन में हमने एक नॉन वॉलेटाइल सॉलिड ऐड कर दिया, वाटर तो वॉलेटाइल था, उसने वॉलेटाइल होकर अपनी वेपर्स दी, बट जैसे ही हम एक नॉन वॉलेटाइल सॉल्यूट ऐड कर रहे हैं, एक सॉलिड ऐड कर रहे हैं, तो उसकी वेपर्स फॉर्म तो होंगी ही नहीं वेपर फेज में. क्यों? क्योंकि वो क्या है, नेचर में नॉन वॉलेटाइल है. अब वो अगर नॉन वॉलेटाइल है, उसकी वेपर्स फॉर्म नहीं होंगी. अब जो वेपर्स आई थी, क्योंकि अभी तक तो पूरे सरफेस पे क्या था, लिक्विड ही लिक्विड था, जब तक हमने एडिशन नहीं करा था तब तक तो हमारी इस पूरे सरफेस पे क्या प्रेजेंट था, लिक्विड प्रेजेंट था, जब तक हमने इसमें कोई भी सॉल्यूट ऐड नहीं करा था. जैसे ही हम कोई सॉल्यूट ऐड कर रहे हैं, तो अब जो उसका सरफेस है, अब उसमें लिक्विड ना प्रेजेंट होके क्या प्रेजेंट है, साथ में कुछ सॉलिड पार्टिकल्स भी प्रेजेंट है उस सरफेस पे. तो उस सरफेस से अब जो वेपर्स का एवोपरेशन है वो क्या होगा, थोड़ा कम हो जाएगा. क्यों कम हो जाएगा? क्योंकि वहां पे कुछ क्या आ गए, सॉल्यूट पार्टिकल्स भी आके अटैच हो गए सरफेस पे, जो कैसे हैं, नॉन वॉलेटाइल हैं, वो वॉलेटाइल नहीं हो सकते हैं. तो जो वेपर्स लिक्विड की वॉलेटाइल हो रही थी, उनका भी कुछ अमाउंट क्या हो जाएगा, कम हो जाएगा. तो ऑन एडिंग अ नॉन वॉलेटाइल सॉल्यूट टू अ सॉल्वेंट, द वेपर प्रेशर ऑफ द सॉल्यूशन गेट डिक्रीज्ड. Why? Because of the accumulation of solute particle on the surface of the solution, on the surface of the liquid in which that solute particle is added. This can be seen by the image also. This image also, this is in this image, initially in image 1, there is only a pure solvent. And due to the presence of only a pure solvent, in the surface of this liquid, over the surface of this liquid, only the vapors of liquids can be formed. These are the vapors of liquids, this pure solvent. Only you can see the vapors of the pure solvent. Now, as you add the non-volatile solute, as in image B, as you add the non-volatile solute to this pure solvent, what will happen now? At this condition, on the surface of the liquid, some solute particle can also attach. These green molecules showing solute particle. So some solute particle also get accumulate on the surface of the liquid, and as they get accumulate on the surface of the liquid, so the escaping of solvent vapors get decreased. Now on the vapor phase, you can see the reduced amount of the vapors of liquid or the solvent. इनिशियली बहुत ज्यादा वेपर्स थे जब कोई भी सॉल्यूट एड नहीं था. जैसे ही सॉल्यूट हमारे पास में एड हुआ, सॉल्यूट मॉलिक्यूल से एक्युमुलेशन दिखाया सरफेस पे, तो जो एस्केपिंग टेंडेंसी है सॉल्वेंट के वेपर्स की वो कम हो गई. तो इसलिए सॉल्वेंट के वेपर्स भी क्या फॉर्म होने लगे, कम फॉर्म होने लगे. एंड नाउ दिस कैन बी फर्दर सीन, द नंबर ऑफ सॉल्वेंट मॉलिक्यूल्स एस्केपिंग फ्रॉम द सर्फेस इज करस्पॉन्डिंगली रिड्यूस. Thus the vapor pressure is also get reduced. That's why on adding a non-volatile solute, the vapor pressure of the solution get decreased. This can further be seen by an example, or we can further say that the decrease in vapor pressure of the solvent, this is important, the decrease in vapor pressure of the solvent depends on the quantity of non-volatile solute present in the solution. It means the amount which you are adding to the non-volatile solute, that depends upon the decrease in vapor pressure depends upon the quantity of the non-volatile solute that has been added to the solvent. Rather, it doesn't depend upon its nature. It never depends upon its nature which you are adding a non-volatile solute. It doesn't depend, the decrement of vapor pressure doesn't depend upon the nature of the non-volatile solute. It will depend only on the amount or the quantity which you are adding to the to the solvent. Now here, this can further be explained with an image, that if a non-volatile solute is added to the solvent, the number of solvent molecules escaping from the surface gets decreased. Due to this, the vapor pressure decreases, and the decrement in the vapor pressure of the solvent depends on the quantity, amount of the non-volatile solute, not on the nature of the non-volatile solute. Now from this, we can conclude and we can come at a point that according to Raoult's law, we can conclude that the when a non-volatile solute is added, only the solvent molecules are present in the vapor phase and contribute to the vapor phase. Then according to Raoult's law, the partial vapor pressure of the solvent particle will be directly proportional to the mole fraction of the solvent particle. Now from this, P1 will directly proportional to X1, and P1 will be equal to, according to Raoult's law, P1 will be equal to X1 into P1 naught. Now on plotting a graph between vapor pressure and mole fraction, we will get a straight line. And this graph shows that the vapor pressure and mole fraction of a solvent is linear in nature. They lie linearly in nature. So this is all about the vapor pressure of liquid solution when solid is added to liquid and when liquid is added to liquid. Now come to the next, that Raoult's law has some special case of Henry's law. Here Raoult's law have some specific cases with Henry's law. As we all know that Raoult's law is equal, can be shown that partial vapor pressure of component 1 will be equal to partial vapor pressure of pure component 1 into its mole fraction when it is present in solution at the same temperature. Similarly, Henry's law, and we discussed Henry's law when we were discussed about the solutions of gas and liquid. So in the solution of gas and liquid, one of the component is so volatile, that is exist as gas, then the Henry's law equal partial pressure of gas will be equal to Henry's law constant into its solubility or its mole fraction, that is P equal to KH into X. Now there are some similarities and differences between Henry's law and Raoult's law, because as in Henry's law and Raoult's law, both depends on the partial pressure and mole fraction. It means in both the laws, partial pressure is directly proportional to mole fraction, but the proportionality sign is different in both the cases. So some similarities are there. First is, both Raoult's law and Henry's law apply to volatile component in the solution. It means when we are talking about volatile components, then we use Raoult's law and Henry's law. But the condition is different. Raoult's law is taken for liquid and liquid type solution, and Henry's law is taken for gas and liquid type solution. In which, in Raoult's law, the volatile component is liquid. Both the liquids are volatile, and in Henry's law, both are volatile, gas and liquid both can volatile, but but gas can volatile in more amount as compared to liquid. This is the similarity between Henry's law and Raoult's law, that both can apply to the volatile compound in the solution. Now, the second similarity, that both laws state that vapor pressure of one component is proportional to the mole fraction of that component. That according to both law, both Henry's law and Raoult's law, that the vapor pressure of one component is proportional to the mole fraction of that component. These are the similarities of Raoult's law and Henry's law. Let's discuss the differences between Henry's law and Raoult's law. Raoult's law defines the proportionality constant as the vapor pressure of the pure component. Raoult's law defines the proportionality constant as the vapor pressure of the component, whereas Henry's law defines the proportionality constant as some experimentally determined values. So, in Raoult's law, the proportionality constant is the vapor pressure of pure component, but in Henry's law, the proportionality constant has some experimentally determined value, that is KH. In Henry's law, the proportionality constant is KH, whereas in Raoult's law, the proportionality constant is vapor pressure of pure component. Here it is P1O, because we are talking about component 1, so the vapor pressure of pure component 1. So, this is all about today, and this is all about the Henry's law and Raoult's law, where Raoult's law is a special case of Henry's law. Now, in our next video, we will discuss then further our next topic. So, stay connected. Thank you.